So I'm excited to do something that's a little bit different for Palantir, to share more of our product vision, the product roadmap, the things that we're excited about, the things that we're building, and really ground that not in what we usually do, which are the things in the world that we're deeply involved with. As Dr. Karp mentioned, the war in Ukraine, distributing vaccines, the work that we've done with many manufacturers and supply chains, but actually in the fundamental technical vision of what we're building. So this company, you know, I'm coming up on 17 years at Palantir. As our customers are often kind to remind us, this is a company filled with amazing people. But I think what actually makes Palantir different is that this is a company that operates in a fundamentally different way. And that I would summarize as believing that the truth is out there. The truth of what is broken, but doesn't have to be, the truth of what is missing in software, it does not exist here in Palo Alto. It exists in the front lines of Donetsk and the factory floors of Detroit, and that's exactly where we go to learn, to discover, and to build. And I think that's pretty different than most of the software industry, which is really set out fundamentally to make software easier to sell. It's minimally viable. It's barely alive. And that's their roadmap, really. When we built Vertex, which BP has credited with over 10,000 barrels of incremental production a day each year since we put it in production, that's hundreds of millions of dollars of value a year, roughly $500 million of value last year alone, we did it specifically to solve deep problems in energy. We couldn't have known when we set out to do that that it would be key to powering BP's energy transition, or that it would power all of the work that we did with manufacturing supply chains in 2020 and 2021, or it was the crucial technology to enable vaccine distribution in the US and the UK. It was exactly by throwing ourselves at our customers' hardest problems over and over again that we were able to envision the maximalist solutions, solutions that deeply and completely solved our customers' problems. And that's what led to us creating this category of the ontology. It's why we know that every business in this room needs the ontology to meet its moment today. I mean, if you think about the investment lots of folks are making, if you say you invest in a cloud data warehouse, that's not your problem. Maybe it's a problem, but it's not the problem. So you've aggregated all of your transactional information to a single store. How does that help your planning tool talk to your pricing tool? Your ERP and your CRM systems still don't speak to each other. Your enterprise is still not connected. And you might say that you don't need it to be connected. But I think we've all seen over the last few years, with the slightest perturbance, all that falls down like a house of cards. And then your folks, the hardworking people in your business that are running the whole institution, they eject. They eject to Excel. They eject to legacy desktop applications. They do a lot of this work in their own heads. That's what happened with Southwest when their software failed them. And they are reacting to the inflexibility and the isolation of the existing systems. And ironically, by ejecting in that sort of way, they're actually further entrenching the inflexibility and isolation of those systems. And so I think you won't be surprised to hear that exactly no one ever said that the solution to these problems was upgrading their ERP, their CRM, their whatever platform to the latest version. To solve these problems, you need an ontology. And Foundry's core ontology allows you to model the semantics, the kinetics, and the dynamics of your business. The semantics represent the real-world elements of your business in full fidelity, the conceptual and object-oriented nature of your business across all of your data types, from streaming, geospatial, your telemetry data, your transactional data, and an extensible framework. Your kinetics allow you to define or mine the behaviors, actions, decisions of your business, to leverage automations, processes, models, to orchestrate and coordinate the existing transactional systems that actually run your business today. You know, upgrading to S4 doesn't make your business better, but implementing a model that determines the optimal allocation of inventories to trucks and distribution centers, and then automatically decisions that by calling back into SAP through our ontology webhooks, that makes your business better. That's worth hundreds of millions of dollars a year, and that's what Tyson Foods shared on this stage in October. Dynamics allow you to evolve your business, to outlearn the market, to run simulations across your enterprise to quantify the potential impact of decisions that you're making, and then to take informed decisions. And so without semantics, kinetics, and dynamics all in one place, automobile companies could not have replanned their entire production process at the beginning of the Ukraine war. BP could not have produced an incremental $500 million of production last year, and hospitals could not be reimagining their operations in a post-COVID world. The cornerstone of our vision is that your business is computable. That's what your procurement software is actually doing. It's doing compute. That's what your CRM is doing, your ERP, your MES. It's even what's happening when your employees escape to their Excel sheets and when they have to escape their own brain to do the work. They're doing compute. But all of this compute, all this business logic, is today scattered across many different systems. And the problem with that is that means it's not composable, it's not reusable, and it's definitely not systematically upgradable. It's like running your business on a series of different assembler languages. It's all very low level. It's very hard to understand what's actually going on. It's even harder yet to improve or evolve any of that. But you need composability, because that's actually the only way that you can deal with increasing complexity. And you need reusability, because that's the only way that you can achieve scale. And you need upgradability, obviously, because you need to evolve your business to meet today's reality. And so Foundry, internal to Foundry, has always been able to do this. These sort of reusable, composable building blocks of logic, that's always been Foundry's secret. What's really powerful, the vision that we have, what we want to share, is transforming Foundry from a walled garden that's capable of doing this to really to something more like Ontology Web Services. It becomes a technology that you build on, an SDK for your enterprise, a library that you would include in your Jupyter notebooks, a world where the API that defines Foundry is actually the product. And that makes all of your business and its logic addressable in your applications anywhere through standards. And once you make your business programmable, you're only limited by your creativity and the physics of the universe. Your legacy investments now actually work for you instead of working against you. Your data drives differentiation and decision-making instead of driving commoditized insights. That's why the Ukrainians are winning the war. Your data, your war as code, is winning. Ontology, in this case, is David's slingshot. So big or small, Ontology allows you to compete on your strengths and not be hobbled by your weaknesses. So let's walk through an illustrative demo here that I think illustrates some of these concepts here. If we start off saying that I'm running a trucking company here, I'm managing hundreds of trucks, I can see all of my trucks on a list, I can click on a truck here and I can see my kind of truck 360, all of my data aggregated in one place, the telemetry data, the geographic data, the history of deliveries. This is semantics, right? I have all my data, whether it's in a cloud data warehouse or anywhere in my enterprise, and I'm able to bring it into the way that I think about the business as the operator. But I need more than that. I need kinetics. I need the models, the processes, the automations, the actions, the verbs that happen to my trucks and happen around my trucks. So let's start with processes here. I have this process. It flows across my ERP system, my CRM system, my third-party logistics systems, you know, many legacy and modern platforms, from the hand of my supplier to the hand of my customer. The trouble is that this sort of state machine, this process, is not well documented, if it's documented at all. It runs through many of these legacy systems. It's hard to understand. It's very complicated. And I would say, as an institution, we do a really good job at any one of these stages. We know how to load trucks. We know how to inspect our trucks. But there's actually nobody who knows how it all really fits together. So the Ontology automatically mines these processes for us, and then it allows me to understand, to manage, and to evolve them. We can see the automations. These are connected business logic that I'm able to trigger and orchestrate across systems that are related to my truck object. Automations allow me to trigger actions programmatically. And I think this is the most powerful kinetic to think about, which is really how do you couple the output of a model to actions directly. And so in here we can see some example automations that drive SMSs to truck drivers or call back into SAP to actually change business logic, or being able to link this to arbitrary code. And all of this is creating these composable business logic building blocks that are easy to govern and can be leveraged anywhere. Again, not just inside of Foundry, but all of my native enterprise applications. and models, which are bound, here we can see the models that are bound to my truck object type. These can be external models that my data science team is building and hosting, or models that are built and hosted in Foundry. But what I think makes models kinetic and really exciting is that it's bound to the ontology. That means that my models know how to read and write the semantics that we were just talking about. The models think in terms of the language of my business. And that means that the model doesn't just take in a file or take in an API call and spit out an inference. It actually takes in objects, properties, the relevant metadata, and it writes that back to the ontology. And I can trigger my models. My models can trigger actions, as I was describing a little bit earlier. And then in this framework, I can understand, you can see that there are two downstream applications that depend on this model. So I have a really built-in way of governing it, to driving change management, ensuring that my models are driving business decisions and not academic insights. The last core part of the kinetics are the actions. And these represent and encapsulate that complex business logic that we've been talking about here. And they can touch many of my existing transactional systems across the entire enterprise and be reused. So here we see we have actions. I've defined how to escalate a maintenance ticket. I can see the applications that implement this action on the left. And on the right, I can see that this action is actually calling back into two of my underlying transactional systems, SAP and Salesforce, to do and kick off the necessary sub-workflows that define what we do when we escalate a maintenance ticket. I think this is so powerful. I'm without having to rip and replace, without having to do an ERP upgrade, I'm able to create APIs that orchestrate all of the existing transactional logic across my enterprise. So that means I need to call into SAP to allocate inventory. Done. That's easy. I need to call into Salesforce to queue up the next best action for a customer. I can do that programmatically. I need to call into Meta Constellation to task satellites to collect imagery over a region. Again, simple. So let's come back to this example here. I want to wire up a new process. I don't know this process that my trucks go through. So I can leverage the existing data integration I have from my, in this case, Snowflake, but it could be BigQuery or Databricks or any cloud data warehouse, to hydrate from the existing transactional log data, the exhaust of how trucks flow through my system, the process. So now I'm able to like see this process for the first time across what would otherwise be like looking into the matrix. So when we look at this process, you know, a lot of this makes sense to me. Things go from loaded to in transit to unloaded, but this doesn't make sense. This is like a forbidden path here. It makes no sense that I take expensive inventory, put it on a truck, and then the truck has to go to maintenance immediately. And while it's not a plurality of my transitions, it's enough of them that it's kind of problematic. So we can investigate this. We can see, okay, how are things flowing here? When I click on this, what's really happening? And what kind of appears is this heuristical pattern. I run my business, so I have some intuition. Not everything has to be immediately an ML model. This is probably where you start. It looks like old, worn engines with heavy loads tend to have this sort of problem. So I have a way of intervening. Now, I am going to ask my data science team to go build a nice, beautiful deep learning model that actually leverages all the telemetry and sensor data I have coming off the truck. And there is a sophisticated way to solve this problem. But right now, I need to stem the bleeding. So while they're doing that, I'm actually right here from this pane of glass going to create an alert that means that when anything is in transit and it's a worn engine and a heavy load, I want to create an alert that drives an automation to escalate the maintenance ticket to do preventative maintenance. I can do that without touching my CRM system, without touching SAP, without touching any of my existing transactional systems. Of course, I am through these APIs, through these actions we've composed, but I can do this from this single pane of glass right here. So I went from no understanding of an end-to-end process to understanding the process to realizing I had a problem with it where I could quickly improve it, all in a single pane of glass. So if we come back to the ontology view here, we can see that, okay, now my process is associated with the object. I have the resulting automation that we just put in here. But then meanwhile, back at the Batcave, the data science team has come up with a beautiful deep learning model that they're ready to support. So I can bring that model right in here. I can bind it to the ontology that we've been talking about. So it knows how to take in the data relevant to these trucks, that's dynamic data that's flowing, and how to tell me and spit out an output. I tie it to this automation, so when the model raises a flag, immediately that's connected up to sending a notification within Foundry, sending an email to the inspection facility, an SMS to my truck drivers, because that's where they live. They live on their phones. They don't have a desktop computer. And then importantly, creating this maintenance ticket that starts flowing through my system and leverages my existing SAP and Salesforce investments. But I can also call this programmatically. So I can build a webhook here to trigger this. So with a simple line of code in your favorite language, I can call this automation to trigger these sorts of workflows. And that gives me a lot of optionality and flexibility. I can then bring all the power that you just saw here in orchestrating and composing these workflows to my existing applications, to the places that we run our business today, without all the brain damage of endless change management. So let's look at this in one slightly more level of detail here. So I'm just connecting to the ontology. I'm getting my truck object type. I'm doing a simple filter to find all alerts that were created today. I'm then able, you can see it right at the bottom half of that screen there, I'm wired up to these actions that we showed you earlier to escalate or to resolve an alert. And this is a trivial amount of code to give a front-end developer the incredible ability to program and orchestrate SAP, Salesforce, all of the big investments in our backend here. So a recap of this. Without duplicating data, I connected to my existing enterprise data stores. I was able to connect to my truck data, all the metadata around it, and use that to hydrate the semantics. Now, the ontology allows me to think in terms of how we think about and model the business. And then we went kinetic. We actually changed our business operations with the agility and the speed of code using actions and automations. We went from a simple, trivial, heuristical model that just alerted me when we had heavy loads on worn engines to a sophisticated ML model that drove actions directly in the context of a workflow. And then I landed all of this where my users are today. You know, the tools they use today, the ontology abstracted away all the complexity of my existing transactional systems, the flows between these systems. It allowed me to centralize my business logic so that I had one place to go where I was able to upgrade my business by upgrading my business logic. And I think this is really quite powerful, this vision of composability, modularity, openness. It allows the ontology to be the SDK of your enterprise. And I think this really matters, because if you can change your business faster, you can execute faster than the pace of disruption, faster than your competitors, faster than market forces. You can respond to reality. And I think this is the weapon to win here. And so as you listen to our other customers talking today, sharing stories, talking about the ontology, I think this is a context to think about. For example, with PG&E, it wasn't sufficient to prevent wildfires to use the SCADA system that controls the grid, or Snowflake that has all the asset data, or Salesforce that has all the customer data. Only the ontology could allow you to bring this all together, to orchestrate them, to execute that at the pace of something that is wildly disruptive. So thank you.